Morning students, today we are going to start with the story Bee Wordsworth by B.S. Noether. So we start with the story. Let's go through the introduction of the author. Someone please read the introduction. Ananya?
Yes, ma'am. Sir, Vidyadhar Suraj Prasad Naipaul. Suraj Prasad Naipaul, born 17 August 1932, is a Trinidadian Nobel Prize winning British writer of Indian origin, known for his comic early novels set in Trinidad and Tobago. His bleaker later novels of the wider world.
Bleaker means? What is the meaning of bleaker?
I'm gloomy.
Yes, gloomy, hopelessness has been expressed in these novels. Right? They are not very optimistic. Right? He has not written about very optimistic themes in these novels. So his bleaker later novels continue.
And his autobiographical chronicles of life and travels. He has published more than 30 books, both of fiction and non-fiction, over some 50 years. Naipaul was knighted in 1989. His earliest book, The Mystic Messiah, 1957, The Suffrage of Elvira, 1958, and Miguel Street, 1959, are ironic and satirical accounts of life in the Caribbean. His fourth novel, A House for Mr. Biswas, 1961, won him major recognition. Naipaul's subsequent novels.
So this book, A House of Mr. Biswas, which was written in 1961, it earned him a lot of fame, right? This book became very popular. And you know that till now, only two Indians have won the Nobel Prize for literature. First one was Rabindranath Tagore, and the second one is B.S. Naipaul. So V.S. Naipaul was not an Indian, technically speaking. He was a British citizen of Indian origin, right? So he also won the Nobel Prize for literature.
Naipaul's subsequent novels continue to explore the personal and collective alienation experienced in new nations that were struggling to integrate their native and Western colonial heritages. Away in the World, 1994, is an essay-like novel examining how history forms individuals' characters. Among Naipaul's non-fiction work are Three Studies of India, An Area of Darkness, 1965, India, A Bounded Civilization, 1977, and India, Wounded Civilization, 1977, and India, A Million Mutinies Now, 1990. Half a Life, 2001, is a novel about an Indian immigrant to England and then Africa. Released the year that Naipaul received the Nobel Prize, Half a Life was considered by many critics to illustrate beautifully the reason that he can win the prize. Miguel Street is a semi-autobiographical novel that focuses on the characters living on Miguel Street, a poor neighborhood set in wartime port of Spain, Trinidad. The story is narrated by a precocious and keenly
What do you mean by precocious? Precocious and keenly observant boy. What do you mean by precocious? Precocious means when there is a very early growth and early development, like early maturity. So this story is narrated. This is a story which we are going to read today. It is narrated by a boy, right? Who is matured and big for his age, more sensible than his age. So, cautious and keenly observant boy. And this boy, who is the narrator of the story, is also a good observer. He is very observant. recounts the myriad lives of quirky inhabitants of this neighborhood. So myriad means
many.
Many, right? Great in numbers, when something which is in large numbers. So that is myriad lives of quirky, very unusual, eccentric, strange, right? Inhabitants of this neighborhood in a witty yet innocent manner. So this book, Miguel Street, has been written by B.S. Naipaul, and it is kind of a semi-autobiographical novel. So the observations which have been expressed by this little boy, they are more or less the observations of the author, right? His own personal observations. So that is why you can say that it is a semi-autobiographical novel, and he has written about the strange inhabitants, strange ways and manners and behaviors of the people living in his neighborhood in a witty yet innocent manner. Because the narrator is a young boy, so obviously he will have some innocence left in him. So the stories of this book, Miguel Street, they have been narrated in a witty, intelligent manner and along with an element of innocence. Undertones of dark humor evoke a mood of sadness. What do you mean by dark humor? Who can tell me what is dark humor? Dark humor means when the subject matter, when a very serious subject matter or grave or painful subject matter is expressed in a very light manner. Right? Something which causes pain, something which causes hurt. That type of topic is picked up and it is expressed in a humorous manner, right? So that is dark humor, or you call it black humor also. It is also known as black comedy. They are more or less these terms more or less have the same meaning. Dark humor, dark comedy, black humor, right? So they are more or less the same. Evoke a mood of sadness because of the tragic nature of the times of those men. So he has dealt with serious, painful topics in a lighter manner. Three Wordsworth is the story of one of these. Yeah. So there is an element of sadness also, and he has used humor, a very expressed the difficult and sad topic in a very humorous manner. I will start with the story, Three Wordsworth. Somebody please read. Akanksha, please read.
Three beggars called punctually every day at the hospitable houses in Mijuel Street. At about 10, an Indian came in his dhoti and white jacket, and we poured a tin of fries into the sack he carried on his back. At 12, an old woman smoking a pipe came, and she got a cent. At 2, a blind man led by a boy called for his penny. Sometimes
wait,
we had.
Wait. Three beggars called punctually every day at the hospitable houses. Hospitable means very generous and very friendly. Means the residents of these houses, they were very generous people. They were hospitable people. They believed in giving alms to the poor, right? Giving money, food, or any other thing to the poor people and the beggars who came to their houses to beg, right? So three beggars, it was a routine that three beggars came every day at about 10. So, and their routine was fixed at about 10 in the morning. An Indian came in his dhoti and white jacket, and used to wear dhoti and white jacket, and he poured a tin of rice into his sack. He carried on his back. And he carried a sack on his back, and the residents of that house, they poured a tin of rice in the sack which he used to carry. At 12, then after 10, at 12 o'clock, an old woman came smoking a pipe, and they used to give a cent. Cent is a small amount of money, right? A small amount of money was given. It's a coin of a lesser value. At 2, a blind man led by a boy came for his penny. And at 2 o'clock, so the first beggar came at 10. The second one, the first beggar was an Indian. He was dressed in dhoti and a white jacket and carried a sack on his back. Then the second beggar came at 12. She was a lady. She used to smoke pipe and she was given a cent. Then the third beggar, who was a blind man, he came and he was led by a boy. A boy used to come along with him so that it is possible for the blind man to not meet with an accident, right? So he was given a penny. So these were the three beggars which came every day. Sometimes we had a row, and at times what happened, there was a row also. So these were very decent beggars. They came every day and they were given money or rice or whatever. Then at times what happened, there were some beggars who were like rogues. Rogues means a worthless person, right? So a disgusting person also visited at times. One day, a man called and said that he was hungry. So one disgusting person, one worthless beggar also came, right? And he said that he was hungry. We gave him a meal. Then the narrator's family provided him with the meal, provided him the food, and he asked for a cigarette. And then after he was fed by the family, he asked for a cigarette and wouldn't go until we had lit it for him. And then after the cigarette, he wanted them to light the cigarette. And he was adamant, he refused to leave the house unless the cigarette was lit for him. So at times, they got these strange, irritating, worthless, disgusting types of beggars also. That man never came again. But that man never came again. It was only once that this man visited the The strangest scholar came one afternoon at about 4. And one day, a man visited their house, and he was perhaps the strangest person who came to their house, according to the narrator. Now we'll come to know what was strange about that person. I had come back from school and was in my home clothes. Right? So the narrator had returned from his school and he had changed his uniform and now he was in his home clothes. The man said to me, "Sonny, may I come inside your house?" So Sonny is an address for a young boy, right? Normally the people who are like we have in India also, no? We say beta, bachcha and babu, these types of addresses, no? We address the small boy like this. So Sonny is an address for the young boy, normally a person who is elder, right, or older in age. He addresses a younger boy like this, Sonny. So the man said, that strange caller, he said that, "Sonny, may I come inside your yard?" So he was asking for permission to enter his premises, to enter his yard. He was a small man and he was tidily dressed. He wore a hat, a white shirt and black hair. So he was a well-dressed man. He was decently dressed. See, the author in these stories has tried to highlight the impact of colonization in places like Trinidad and Tobago. Right? These stories are basically based in the background or the setting of the story is basically Trinidad and Tobago, and these were the colonies of the English, like the rest of the world, like India also. So the impact of the colonizers has been highlighted by the narrator, by the author, in these lines. This man who came, he was dressed like an Englishman. He wore a hat, he wore black trousers and a white shirt, and he was very neatly and tidily dressed. So he was a kind of a colonized man. Colonized man means he was dressed like the colonizers of Trinidad. I asked, what do you want? So the narrator, being a young boy, he asked, what do you want? He said, I want to watch your bees. So this is why the narrator has said that he was the strangest scholar. He didn't ask for money. He didn't ask for food. He didn't ask for anything else. He only wanted to watch the bees which were there in his garden. He had four small grugru palm trees, and they were full of uninvited bees. So grugru palm tree is a type of a palm tree of, grown in the tropical regions of North and South America. So it is a variety of a palm tree popular in North and South America, right? So they had grugru palm trees in their garden, and those trees were full of uninvited bees, right? So uninvited bees means they came on their own. The bees, they came on those trees on their own. I ran up the steps and shouted. So this, he was a young boy, and so he didn't know what to do. So he just went inside, like small children do, no? Whenever we have beggars at our home, for what will a small child do? He starts screaming, "Mummy, Papa, somebody has come at the door. Somebody is asking for money," right? So he, being a young boy, he went inside, he ran up the steps and shouted. And perhaps the request of this man was also not the normal one. And so that is why he had to rush inside to ask his mother. Right? I ran up the steps and shouted, "Ma, it have a man outside here. He say he want to watch the bees." So he said that there is a man in, outside, and he is requesting to watch the bees. Right? He wants to watch the bees. My mother came out, looked at the man, and asked in an unfriendly manner, "What do you want?" Like the mothers in our country also, right? Whenever we have a beggar, I don't think the a normal Indian mother is very happy. Two reasons. The first is that she's disturbed from the job which she's doing. The Indian mothers are very busy people, right? So they are disturbed from their task, whatever they are doing. And secondly, a beggar is very irritating. And the salesman, the other person, is very irritating. So the mother was very irritated, and she came and she asked in an unfriendly way, "What do you want?" The man said, "I want to watch your bees." So the man said that, "I just have a simple request that I want to watch the bees on the grugru palm trees in your yard." His English was so good, it didn't sound natural. And I could see my mother was worried. Right? So he spoke very good English. So it didn't sound natural. Right? So again, this also shows that he was a colonized man. The way he dressed up very decently, like an English, like the English people do, right? And then his accent, the way he spoke English, right? It was so good. It sounded wonderful. Though it was not natural. Not natural means he was English was not his first language. So any language which is not your first language, you cannot have the original accent of that language. It becomes very difficult. Right? So he was acting like an Englishman. His appearance was like an Englishman. and his accent, his English was also like an Englishman, right? So he adopted the language of the colonizers, right? And in spite of the fact that it sounded good, it was not natural. That is why it is written, it didn't sound natural. And I could see my mother was worried. And this was something which worried the mother. She said to me, stay here and watch him while he watched the piece. So this boy, the narrator, was assigned the job of staying there and watching the man. And the man was supposed to watch the bee, because this is what he wanted. He wanted to watch the bee. You can make a note that this man spoke not in his original accent. So what can we make out about this man? That he had given up his original Trinidadian identity, right? And adopted the English ways and manners, right? Even his language was like an Englishman. The man said, thank you, madam. You have done a good deed today. He spoke very slowly and very correctly, as though every word was costing him. If you have seen and how the English people, they speak, right? They speak very slowly, right? In a very sophisticated manner than the rest of the world. There is a lot of difference in the way the Americans speak English and the rest of the world speaks English, and the way the people of Britain speak English. And in the post times, in olden times, before the advent of this IT industry, they were even more refined. Right? Their language was even more refined and sophisticated. So he was also speaking in that fashion. He spoke very slowly and very correctly, as though every word was costing him money. So with a lot of sophistication, he spoke. We watched the bees, this man and I, for about an hour, squatting near the palm tree. So they squatted near the palm tree, and they were squatting means when you crouch, when you bend your knees and you crouch. So both these people, that is the narrator and that man, the stranger, they went on watching the bees for an hour. The man said, I like watching bees. Sorry, do you like watching bees? So after about spending an hour watching the bees in that squatted position, the man said that he is fond of watching the bees. And then he asked the boy, the narrator, that do you also like watching the bees? I said, I aren't at time. So the boy said, the young boy, he was a young boy, so he was very innocent and honest. And he said that I don't have time to watch this. He shook his head sadly. He said, that's what I do. I just watch. I can watch ants for days. Have you ever watched ants and scorpions and centipedes? And congruous, have you watched those? So he says that, have you watched these animals? So what can you make out from these lines about the stranger? Anyone?
He's probably an animal lover.
Yes. Lover of nature, you can say. Right? So that love of nature, love for nature, this particular theme has been highlighted in these lines. Person can spend hours and days watching these beauties of nature, these creatures of nature, like ants, bees, then he definitely is in love with nature. Right? He's able to connect with nature. And you can connect with nature only when you have love. Can connect with anything in this world only when you have a feeling of affection, feeling of love for that particular thing. So he had this love for nature. I shook my head. I said, what you does do, mister? So this young boy asked him, what do you do? What do you do means, what do you do for a living? He got up and said, I am a poet. So then he said that he was a poet. Another fact which tells us that he was a nature lover. All these poets, they have a strong affinity towards nature. They are like, have a very strong bond, connection with nature. I said, a good poet. So the boy, being very young, he said, oh, so you are a good poet. Are you a good poet? He said, the greatest in the world. So that stranger replied that I am perhaps the greatest poet in the world. What your name, mister? So now the boy was curious. He wanted to know the name. He said, okay, fine. If you are the greatest poet in the world, please tell me your name. I want to know your name. P. Wordsworth. So the stranger said that his name was P. Wordsworth. P for Bill. So the boy asked, and what does B stand for? Does B stand for Bill? Black. Black Wordsworth. White Wordsworth was my brother. We share one heart. I can watch a small flower like the morning glory in the crowd. Right? So he said that no. B, my name stands for Black. And my brother was White Wordsworth. And we have a lot in common. We share the same heart. Means we have the same feelings. Right? We feel in the same way. Both of us are sensitive. And I can watch a small flower like the morning glory in the crowd. And then he told the little boy that I am so sensitive. Right? A poet needs to be sensitive. Why? Why does a poem need to be sensitive? You will not be able to write anything without being sensitive towards the surroundings and towards the environment. His sensitivity will move him, will touch him. Then only he will be able to use words to express. Any kind of artist needs to be sensitive, whether it is a poet, whether he is a painter, whether he is a writer, whether he is a singer. If he doesn't have that sensitivity, if he cannot understand the pain, the feelings, the emotions, love, and is an emotionless person, is an insensitive person, then he will not be able to be a good poet, a good writer, a good painter, or whatever. Right? So, every artist is sensitive. So, he is talking about his sensitivity in this line, and he says that I can watch a flower like the morning glory and flower. Only a poet can do it. Or an artist can do it. A normal person, a normal insensitive person, will not be able to connect with himself with that flower in that manner. That it can excite his emotion and bring tears to his eyes. I said, why he does cry? So the boy said, the boy found it strange and he asked, why? Why do you cry while looking at the small flower like morning glory? What is there to cry in it? He didn't understand. Yes. One more thing. See, there is a pun in his name. Yeah. Says now that the bee for black. So there is a pun in the name of this person, P. Wordsworth. What is the pun? Can you remember or recollect any other poem, any other poet with his name, Wordsworth? Yes, possible. So please unmute Kostubh. Which other poet can you think of?
Kostubh unmute. I'm giving you option.
I'm William Wordsworth.
William Wordsworth. So this is the pun, right? He called himself the greatest poet, the greatest in the world, right? And then his name has what? And then his name has Wordsworth in it. Wordsworth, William Wordsworth was one of the greatest poets in the world. Right? And then he was a nature poet. And this person, B. Wordsworth, has already expressed his love for nature. William Wordsworth was a poet who was connected to nature, right? He, all his poems are related to nature. Then, the next line he says, I can watch a small flower like the morning glory and cry. This line tells about his love for nature. So, he is kind of, that is why I said that there is a pun in his vein, right? He is kind of comparing, when he talks about these things, he is kind of relating himself to one of the greatest poets of the world, and that is William Wordsworth. Clear? So the boy asked, I said, why you does cry? Why do you cry? Why, boy? Why? You will know when you grow up. So, B. Wordsworth said that, why cannot I cry while looking at the morning glory? You will not understand this because it's not your age, right? These things are too difficult for your age, at your age, to understand. But once you grow up, you will come to know why can a person cry while looking at a simple flower, a simple small flower like the morning glory. You are a poet too. And see, now what he's doing, he tells the boy, the narrator, that there is a poet inside you also. You are also a poet, you know. And when you are a poet, you can cry for it. And then he says, once there is a poet inside you, you can cry at anything. I couldn't laugh, he said. You like your mother? So, boy actually couldn't laugh at this, and then he said that you like your mother. Then he asked this question to the narrator, that do you like your mother when she is not beating you? So the boy said that I like her only when she is not beating me. So most of the time I get a beating from her. He pulled out a printed sheet from his hip pocket and said, on this paper is the greatest poem about mothers. And I'm going to sell it to you at a bargain price, 4 cents, right? So that is why he asked that, do you like your mother? So he wanted to know whether the boy likes the mother in the first place or not. If he doesn't like his mother, then obviously why would he buy a poem for his mother? And so once he said that I like her and she is not beating me, he, Mr. Wordsworth, that is B. Wordsworth, took out the poem from his pocket and he said that I have written a poem about mothers and I am going to sell you at a bargain price, right? At a discounted price, at the lowest price. Then, what is the bargain price? Price lesser than the original price, right? The actual value. So, I am giving you a bargain price means the real worth, the real value of this poem is higher than what I am offering you. But I am ready to give it to you just for 4 cents. I went inside and said, Ma, you want to buy a poetry for 4 cents? Obviously, the small child will not have 4 cents. He will have to request his mother. So he went inside and asked his mother, Ma, do you want to buy a poetry for 4 cents? The mother said, you know, how will the mother react? Right? My mother said, tell that blasted man to haul his tail away from my yard. You hear? So, means to leave my premise immediately. That is the meaning. That, tell that blasted means that irritating, annoying, disgusting man to leave my, to take his tail away from my yard means to leave my yard immediately. Here, have you got it? Do you understand? I said to be heard, but this boy, he didn't want to heard people were hurt, and so he went outside and he said, my mother says she answered me. He didn't repeat the words of his mother. He very decently told people that my mother doesn't have four saints. So I'm sorry I cannot tie on. So I think it's almost time, and we will end here.